It's Wednesday, in fact. It's 3 o'clock and it's Together Unlocked. I'm Jew Gosling, artist and artistic director of Together 2012, which is bringing you this live stream today. And with me in my East London studio is...
Julie Newman. I'm the chair of Together 2012.
And an artist in her own right too. So before we do a bit of audio description, we're going to go over to the other half of our virtual sofa in the West Midlands and have some introductions and audio description there.
Yeah, hi. So I'm Robin Surgener. I am the business director of Together 2012 and co-host of one of the many co-hosts of Together Unlocked. I will describe myself now, as you get to know what I look like first. You don't need to know what anyone else looks like after that, honestly. I have lovely, lovely, shiny silver white hair today. No rimmed, silver armed spectacles, half shaven, and I am wearing a grey Rolling Stones t-shirt with a picture of a very big mouth on the front of it. Very iconic Rolling Stones symbol, if you do know what that looks like. Big red lips and a tongue sticking out.
I am Josh Surgeon. I'm also one of the hosts of Together TV, and I am a research student when we're allowed out of our houses. And I am wearing a perfectly blocked by the microphone, which way do I need to go? Black t-shirt with a gold star and gold silhouette, and that is the logo of the Hamilton musical.
Wonderful. Julie?
I've got silver and gold hair. Currently, I've been experimenting with product, so it's a bit all over the place. Looks a little bit greasy, but it's a look I'm getting used to. I have dark rimmed glasses, a white t-shirt which says Choose Love, which is an Amnesty International slogan.
Josh looks slightly horrified over there in the West Midlands, not quite sure why.
No, I thought you were getting ready for the dressing up to go nowhere on Friday.
Well, we'll come on to that. I'm Jew Gosling. I'm in my late 50s. I've got short but growing henna red hair, black plastic glasses, and I have a green t-shirt on, and across it in pink says Equal. Behind us, we have the Together 2012 banner, which has graffiti-type images of all the different activities we do, from music, dance, photography, film, art, drama, and a whole lot more, which we will be talking about later. If you're watching this live stream on YouTube and you like live subtitles, then if you go to our website, which is www.together2012.org.uk, click on Together TV, you will see the live stream is embedded there, and beneath it, there are live captions. Thank you very much indeed to Julia from Global Retime Captioning for this service. And then tonight by 8 o'clock, we post a recording of the day's show, and that will have the captions included fully in the script. So either way, you can watch us with captions now, or you can watch us with captions later. If you'd like to join in on live chat, you do need to click on the stream and go to YouTube, and then you can message us from there. So we're a Paralympic legacy organisation. We were founded by disabled artists in the main London 2012 host borough of Newham in 2013, following the success of our volunteer-led 2012 festival. Now we run an artistic programme which is free for everybody, led by disabled artists. So particularly in Disability History Month, which is November and December, we have a month-long festival with screenings, performances, exhibitions, street art, carnival art. And this year, that will still be going ahead, but online, so actually bigger and more accessible than ever. We also run a year-round outreach programme, which means that on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday and Friday mornings in East Ham, free for anybody who can get there, for disabled people and whoever they want to bring with them. We have disabled-led creative workshops. And on a Wednesday morning, it would be a pop-up poetry club. Julie, do you want to just tell us a little bit about the pop-up poetry club and what's happening with it today?
Sure, yes. Wednesday's Poetry Day, which is lovely. We started off a couple of weeks ago, literally 2 weeks ago, actually, with a phone service where we could contact people and they could phone in. There were a few technical problems with that, so we're changing the system over. It's been cancelled for today, but hopefully we'll start it again next Wednesday. The idea is at about 10:15, you get yourself a cup of tea, you get yourself a bit of paper and a pencil or a pen, and something to read, a poem that you've found or have written yourself to read out for everybody else. And by 10:30, we should be all ready to go. All the participants would have joined in and introduced themselves. It's led by Alison Marchant, and she will show us or explain to us the topic for that week. I'm trying desperately to remember what the topic for the next time is, and I just can't off the top of my head. I'll have to check it and bring it in on Thursday or Monday. And then what happens is that everybody reads a poem. There's some sort of comment about it from those who want to comment, particularly if it's written by the person who's reading it. It's usually nice to have a little bit of feedback about their poetry. And then we break at 11 o'clock for half an hour while everybody goes off and writes a new poem and has a cup of tea or glass of water, whatever they need to do. And then we come back at 11:30. They'll be phoned back in, and it's like a conference call where everybody can hear everybody else. And that's the opportunity to read everybody reads their own poems. And again, there's an opportunity to comment. I have to say very clearly, actually, that the comments and the criticisms are always positive. I've never, ever heard anybody say anything negative about somebody else's poetry or their choice of poem if they're going to read it. I find it a very supportive atmosphere. And over the years, I've dipped in and dipped out of it because I'm not operational usually. I'm not a workshop leader generally, only for specialist workshops. But when I have popped in and out of this group, I'm always impressed at how sophisticated some of the poems are, and also how people are constantly expanding their skills. I'm really excited about the fact that we're going to have a new Together poetry book out in the autumn. I think we're going to have some very, very interesting and very good poems to include in it.
Yes, and I'll come on to that in a minute. We have a very comprehensive Join In From Home program based on our website. You don't have to be anything to do with East London or indeed disabled to join in. The activities are sort of mapped according to the clubs that we would usually run. And the pop-up poetry club activity is to write a poem on the theme of together. And we invite you to send those poems into us to share on social media and on the live stream. And in the autumn, we'll be publishing a physical book and an ebook of those poems on the theme of together. Everybody who contributes to the book will get a copy of the physical book. I say that because quite often you don't as a poet. So that's our challenge. But we also welcome poems from you on any subject. I have a contribution from the audience on the theme of together, which I'm going to play in a minute. But I'm just thinking, Julie, could you first read Alison's poem that she wrote last week? And I think Alison Marchant is an international mid-career artist. She lives in Stratford, although in fact she's supporting her mother in Essex at the moment. And Alison's an artist with dyslexia, and she's written quite a bit about that. And I remember when we first started poetry, she was utterly convinced that she couldn't participate in poetry at all. And of course, now she's actually leading it. So I think, am I right in saying last week they had the theme of landscape? And I think we read some of their poems from last week's group last Wednesday. So this, I believe, is called
Interior Landscape. And this is by Alison Marchant. The series of scenes are played out in an interior landscape. The crumpled sheets of my bed mirror patterns of waves. The little boy next door is painting rainbows from rock pools. Yesterday, the bay windows cast sunlight into the dusty rooms, tiny particles of dust turning, falling. At night time, lone cars move shadows with headlights. On my mother's 1940s side table, the radio transmits the shipping forecast.
I think that was lovely. So I know you can't actually watch this at the moment, Alison, but when you do get to catch up with it, thank you very much indeed. In a minute, we're going to be joined by our virtual writer in residence, Penny Pepper. We're very pleased that we had a virtual writer in residence before it was strictly necessary. But first, I'm going to play us this by Emily Bonner, which is her poem on the theme of together.
So this is my poem that I threw together late last night and finished off this morning when I should have been sleeping. So I am feeling a little bit tired, but we will rise together. Each and every one of us holding a virtual hand. This ain't no disaster, it's a cleansing of the land. Some may clap the NHS and others bang their lids. People standing in the streets, men, women, dogs and kids. As air pollution decreases, the Himalayas emerge, showing their strength and beauty, secrets on the verge. Clear waters now run in Venice, first time in an age. No more millions of tourists, a turning of the page. Nature is now healing from devastation caused by man. In a way, it's payback time, it's all part of the plan. Sadly, lives will be lost from one thing or another. Hand gel can't save us all, and nor can the Holy Mother. So what will get us through? The power of the mind, living in the moment and always being kind. A collective of positivity connecting to the source. Being non-judgmental will keep you all on course. So breathe, motherfucker, just like Wim Hof says, and find a productive way to while away the days. Let's be creative and discover who we are. Everyone matters, those close and those afar. All rise together, guys, and be a shining light. This time is a blessing. My love to you, day and night.
Thank you so much, Emily. That was wonderful. And now we're going to bring in our writer in residence, Penny Pepper from Hastings.
Hello.
Hello, Penny.
Hello. I'll just describe myself. So I'm against a pink backdrop, a pink screen, and I am in my wheelchair with a stripy pink top. My hair is a tone of red with some grey, and I am wearing thin wire glasses with purple, what do they call them, purple arms, hands, side bits, and I have a couple of bracelets on.
You are a symphony in pink, basically.
I am, as usual, yeah. Oh, I have a cute little badge I found today, which is a poodle. It's a little sparkly poodle in a 1950s style.
And you seem to have a very sparkly hairband. Is that around your...
I have. I've got like a little pearl hairband because my hair is suffering a bit like everyone's with the lockdown. So,
well, it's very grey in London, so it's lovely to suddenly have all this sparkly pink coming.
It is grey in Hastings as well, sadly. And even Pixie won't go out, which is unusual. She normally sits on the windowsill. And but she won't.
Yeah, Pixie's your cat, isn't she?
Here's my little black cat who sticks out her tongue.
We had what would have been called a stage invasion by cats sets on Monday, and two of them have just broken out again here in East London. But I should say we've just put up a new page, which is called Together TV's Animal Hosts, and Pixie is featured there.
So, oh, lovely.
So if anybody wants to know more about the random cats and dogs you see in the background, that's where you'll find it. So you're going to start with a poem, is that right, Penny?
I am going to start with a poem, and it's from my book, and it's called Bookworm, and it's about, as a kid, not being able to find books that really spoke to me as a disabled kid. And this comes from that, and it's called Bookworm. Peter and Jane go up the hill, but I want to go through the wardrobe where Narnia lies on the other side. I want to be in the famous five to chase the spies and be a tomboy. I want the world I find in books. The naughtiest girls in poshest schools, tucking in to midnight feasts, jolly japes and playing pranks. Are you in the Anglo-Saxon League, with houses at school for Grace and Daphne? This is the world I find in books. Ballerinas at the bar, arabesques danced on point, the tutu puffs in perfect pink, accidents and crippled teachers, but always the girl who becomes a star. This is the world I find in books. Up the mountains with smiley Heidi, granddaddy scary, and I don't like Peter. Switzerland, it's clean and pure. I wonder if I could breathe that air, would I walk like Clara if I'm good? This is the world I find in books. Mary scowls and spoilt Colin whines. A secret garden. The boy with robins makes us happy. He's kind and bold. Colin walks tall when he tries hard. Positive thinking will cure us all. This is the world I find in books. I take a pen and write some words to tell the stories I never found of poor kids, crip kids kicking out where girls fly free and save the world. Adventures made for everyone. This is the world I make in books.
Brilliant. So, I'm just bringing the others back in to join us. That was fabulous, Penny. Do you want to tell us a bit more about that book?
This is my poetry collection, which has been out for 2 years, Come Home Alive. And there's me on the front cover in a steampunk wheelchair. And my head has been put on the body of the the Botticelli Venus, because we just wanted it to be punky and fun, and it is in a punky lettering like the Sex Pistols album. We wanted to copy that. It is available. Best place to get it is the Burning Eye Books website. It's not available on Amazon at the moment, but that's probably a good thing.
Well, another of the pages that we have under the Together 2012 link on the website is our highlights page. And each day we put up the links to anything that we mention on the show. So we'll make sure we put that up. So it's
Burning Eye Books.
Burning Eye Books.
And yeah, you'd find my profile on their website as a poet. And there's a link there to buy it.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
It's been in Hastings.
It's been a bit grey. I did manage to go out with my partner Kev at the weekend. We managed to get him a power chair, an electric power chair, which is the first time he's used one, because Hastings is hilly. That is one of the minuses when you're a wheelchair user, but with a power chair or a scooter, that is resolved. And so we went down to the seafront and we had a little picnic. So it's sad the weather's dropped again now, so that's a little sad. But otherwise, you know, life ticks on by the seaside.
Well, it sounds lovely. We do see seagulls going overhead, and that's what, as we don't, as I can't really go to the front, past the front door without kind of suiting up because we're less than 2 meters from the street. Yeah, I can only dream about it, and I do dream about it. Do you dream about beaches and things, or indeed surgeoners, because you would usually be swimming practically every day? What do you dream about?
Sorry, is there an age rating on this show? No.
Family friendly.
Go on, Josh.
I don't dream a huge amount, really, or at least to remember them. And then the ones that I do have tend to be really nerdy, and I'm like in Star Trek or I'm Iron Man or something like that. So it's less kind of picturesque landscapes and more raging space wars, but that's just because I'm a nerd, I think.
Yeah, I think my dreams are so random and move from one place to another. They're like completely hectic. I'm not sure what that says about me, but they're kind of not even boltable together.
Well, it sounds like Josh's dreams are no different to before lockdown, and indeed you can access that virtual world just as easily, which we will be coming onto, because every Wednesday we talk about gaming, virtual sport, and we race clockwork toys for the right of our teddy bears to wear a gold medal. So we have all of that coming up in the second half. Oh, and quite by coincidence, the teddy bear behind me is a white bear called Emily, and surgeoners have a white bear, and his Penny's bear, complete with...
Oh, look at that, they're all in white.
Well, Penny's looks kind of older and much loved, but I love the leopard skin necktie.
Yeah, he's got a necktie.
Ours is date stamped. I don't know if you can see that. Emily has a thing for that. When she has another couple of these, and when she was younger, she thought the bear was called Harrod. So the bears are all called Harrod, even though it's, you know, they're from Harrods, but she just thought that was what the bear was called, which is lovely. So we have, this is Snow Harrod.
Well, this is Emily, was named after Emily Pankhurst, and she's actually wearing some interesting headgear, which is sort of, I think, made of a strip of card stapled and covered with tape, and then the letters sail cut out. And that was actually a costume from one of the Newham carnivals. So that's what Emily is wearing. How long has your teddy had his lovely leopard skin scarf, Penny?
Quite a while, because he's had some little throat injuries over the time. Because he is like 69 years old. No, sorry, not 69. I'm at 59. But he's got like a little hole underneath. So it kind of, it's like a very decorative neck collar, really. So.
It's a disability aid, isn't it? It's a disabled bear, basically.
It is a disabled bear, and he's made it through all those years fairly intact. So, and now Pixie sleeps with him. She looked a little bit moody when I moved him off the bed. So, I'll rest him for a bit.
Well, we'll leave you for now, Penny, but you're going to come join us later, aren't you? And also going to read us another poem.
Yep.
And we might even be able to see a little bit of Pixie as well. So we'll see you very soon.
Okay.
Me can stay there.
Yes, your teddy bear can indeed stay there. So one of the things that we're discussing this month is it's Newham Heritage Month. On Monday, we talked about the Newham Heritage Month theme, which is the theme of home. And we're going to talk a little bit more about what's on offer. I'm just going to adjust something on the screen. I know you should be able to see us more clearly and the captions more clearly on the recording as well. So what they're doing is it's a completely virtual festival. They've got some activities already on the website, and then they're adding the activities that are released each day at midnight the night before. So today they have released a very interesting video and information about Tony Cheeseman, who was a black activist and musician. And there's also a black performance arts workshop. So both of those are available on the website. The link is on our highlights page, but it's basically newhamheritagemonth.com. It's very straightforward. Oh, no, I tell a lie. It's newhamheritagemonth.org and not a .org.uk, just a .org. Tomorrow, there's going to be a live performance, I think probably over Zoom, of drumming from Iroko. So it's Iroko and Talking Drums. I think it's going to be live on Facebook, but you get the link if you just go onto the page. And then on Friday morning from 11 to 12, there's going to be a live streamed illustration workshop, which is for young people during lockdown and also carers. And it's how to make homemade ink out of instant coffee. So that does actually sound pretty nerdy. So I have all the direct links to these activities, and I'm going to put them in to the highlights page. So let me just pop this one down. And I think that links in quite nicely with, we wanted to say something about the Black Lives Matters campaign, and in particular, the Young Black Lives Matter campaign, which Together 2012 launched yesterday. Julie spoke on Friday about our organisation's commitment to equality, diversity and inclusion, but we think slogans are simply not enough. We are rather sick already of hearing slogans from organisations that actually could do something. The thing that we are focusing on is the fact that in the London Borough of Newham, fewer disabled young people have access to an education and healthcare plan than anywhere else in the UK. Across London, 3% of young people have access to a plan, and that plan gives them entitlement to all sorts of things, extra support in school. And at the moment, yeah, it's all right, Julie, we'll just let the cats go mad till we hear a scream, and then I'll suddenly come off the screen and leave the boys to talk. But to go back to what's a very, very important issue, across London, 3% of young people have this plan. And at the moment, under lockdown, this is also giving them the right to have free IT equipment, to go to school when the schools are closed, to have access to food and weekly support calls, additional mental health support, a whole raft of other benefits. Now, in Newham, we have twice the average proportion of people with visual impairments, with hearing impairments, twice the proportion of residents are disabled when they enter retirement, you know, twice. I mean, it's really kind of hard to believe. So we would expect that more than 3% of our young people would have what used to be called a statement and is now an education and healthcare plan, and that protects and supports them right up to the age of 25. We estimate that as an absolute minimum, 1,500 young people up to the age of 18 have been left without one of these plans, and simply because of the diversity of the borough, we know that the vast, vast majority of these are young people of colour. And when young disabled people don't get support, they're much more likely to be formally or informally excluded from school, groomed into gangs, you know, and just drawn into a life of poor mental health and criminality. We have one of the highest youth murder rates in the UK, and that has to be linked to the fact that these young people are being treated as criminal and not seen as the disabled young people in need that they are. So we've launched this campaign. We're in particular lobbying our MPs, Stephen Timms and Lynn Brown, and the Mayor of Newham, Roxana Fiaz. We have an email newsletter that you can sign up to on our contact page, and that also has details, but we will be putting that in the links page too, of exactly who you can write to and how you can help. We really hope that people can spread awareness of this. It's not a campaign that should simply be led by people of colour. It's down to all of us to take action about a situation that has just should never have happened and has gone on for far too long. Did you want to add anything as chair, Julie, before I move on?
I really welcome this action. I think it's, as you said, very important that Black Lives Matter, Young Black Lives Matter as well, get across the board support. I think particularly from those of us who have some sort of insight into the impact of discrimination and prejudice. Obviously, it's different because we're not being racially abused, those of us who are white. But I think at the same time, you know, we really need to demonstrate that we can move alongside each other and be actively supportive and seen to be supporting. Then there can be no question about where our politics lie or where our hearts lie. Our hearts have to lie with an open and inclusive society where there's no place for racism or disableism.
And I think it's important to remember how much support disabled people in the arts have had from people of colour. So when the Oscars So White campaign started 3 years ago, an organisation was set up called Act for Change. And Act for Change, right from the start, have also been highlighting issues around discrimination against disabled actors. Which is a nice link. We now have a film from our associate drama company, ACT UP Newham. Most of the members of ACT UP Newham are disabled people of colour. They have been doing wonderful things in Newham for over 10 years, but when it comes to the wider disability arts world, we have been very disappointed that however many invitations have been sent out, the kind of the Arts Council haven't come to see them even when they funded it. The Unlimited programme, which holds hundreds of thousands of pounds worth of funding for disability arts, have never come to see a single performance or a single show. And I think that is another key issue. We are simply, well, I say we, in fact, the vast majority of people participating in our programmes and the vast majority of the locally based artists we programme are people of colour. The difficulty is that that's just not happening on a national picture. So again, that is something that we're really going to be challenging the art world and challenging the disability art world about this year. But in the meantime, here's ACT UP's weekly offering, which this week is entitled Morning Thoughts.
Let me
I wish I was famous.
Let me pray before having my shower. Or I should pray after.
Today I'm going to watch the news, but I bet they will say the dead same thing.
I miss my sleep. I still don't make it.
Should I work online? Pay today or watch TV?
I hope my boyfriend still loves me.
Damn, this world is so depressing.
Because there's so much time now, I can do something worthwhile. I shouldn't be bored and angry. I should do housework.
What can I bake today?
Look at those people walking outside in the coronavirus. They're going to catch it.
Watch suit watching TV.
Well, I'm so damn well, I'm pretty.
I shouldn't stay any longer in bed.
I hope my family is well.
Ugh, coronavirus is such an evil bitch.
And as usual, I thought that was very powerful and very well done. It was so impressive to me that ACT UP moved over to working on Zoom and just carried on rehearsing and making work every single week right since lockdown.
Absolutely.
How hard is it to coordinate, what was it, eight or nine actors so that you've got a coherent film and one that is, as you say, very, very powerful. I think they're excellent. I'm really impressed at everything they're doing.
So, before we bring Penny back in, I can see that this teddy bear is getting closer and closer and closer to the screen in the West Midlands and is clearly desperate to win. However, there has been some discussion about cheating and whether one of the clockwork toys is known to be particularly slow. So I must push you, Josh, to say right or left this time.
Is that stage right or stage left?
When you're looking at the screen, I have a screen.
Right.
Right. Okay, fair enough. I'm sure you'll win again, but, you know, just to try and make
it. She's not going to win again.
We can assure you there is no cheating whatsoever.
There's absolutely no cheating going on. We don't cheat. We are athletes.
You probably don't need to cheat because you are just the most family in the world. But for anybody who can't see it, you're about to see two clockwork grannies in their racing power wheelchairs driving down the passageway outside my studio, complete with wandering cats. So I'm going to stick this on solo. It's only about 10 seconds. And they're off. And the one on the right.
Lost. Yeah. So we won. Da 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 da.
Yes, we will accept that. I mean, you know, your one did cut us off halfway up there, and there'd definitely be a steward's complaint going on if that was a Formula One race.
Or an athletics race.
Yeah.
Absolutely believe that.
Cannot change lanes in the 100 metres. It's not allowed.
So we have our gold plastic medal as presented to us by the Mayor of Newham in London.
I'll be back.
Well, well, our teddy bear Emily now has her carnival headgear and her gold medal on.
I have to say that listening to Penny's audio description earlier, I've come to the conclusion that I am woefully under accessorized, and I'm going to have to work out what I can adorn myself with for future Wednesdays, I think.
Well, we do talk about it being Pride Month as well, so that's entirely appropriate. Even if you don't identify as part of any of that community, we still encourage people to dress up and express that side.
And we can be Penny's friends, can't we? With lots of glitter.
Perhaps we should set up a new national movement, Friends of Penny, and we all wear pink.
Sure.
Yes, there's one book. But before we rejoin Penny, I just wanted to come back to Josh because it's time for some virtual sport and to just tell us what the latest situation is in terms of what we can watch online and on the TV.
So we'll go to gaming first. Yesterday evening, Rowan and I started playing a new co-op only game together. which, you know, if you do have someone that you can play games with, that's always kind of really quite enjoyable. Things like Portal, the kind of puzzle games, are really good fun. And having never played a computer game since about 1999, I had some friendly family frustration with him, but he did learn. He walked into a lot of corners, refused to turn around quite a lot. But after kind of 10 minutes or something, he'd kind of learned to use both his thumbs at the same time to walk around and turn around. And it just kind of shows that, you know, having never played something like that before, you actually picked it up really quickly.
It's not what you told Emily.
No, I was much more harsh, and I was taking the mick out of him yesterday. But no, I think the point was that, you know, if you haven't played games before, or, you know, you've got a family member home because of lockdown, and you're wanting to kind of engage with them in them playing, that actually most things you can kind of pick up, and after 10 minutes of being a bit naff, you can kind of you can get it down enough to actually kind of take part. I don't know if you want to jump in with kind of your experiences of learning.
Yeah, no, I'm not actually going to try and defend myself at all. I was awful to start with, and it's, I'm not used to using, you know, last time I played a game like that, when you walked, you had one thingy, one joystick, and it turned, and you didn't, whereas this one, you walk with one side and see with the other side. So, but I have to say that actually, yes, once I've kind of got to grips with it, and the game, which we haven't mentioned the name yet, Josh will tell you, although I will say that
it's quite a grown-up
game. Yeah, it had
a theme.
It had some choice language. It's about two gentlemen escaping from prison. But actually, the cooperative element of it, once you got to grips with it, for example, you had to stop a fan from spinning, and you couldn't do it on your own. There was different actions without explaining the game, but Josh had to do something. I had to respond to that and then go through and do something on the other side to allow him to come through. And if you didn't do both elements of it, there was a really good bit when we were both in cells. It's an American jail with bars rather than walls and doors. Whoever wasn't digging their way out the back of their cell was watching the guards go up and down the corridor outside and warning the other player when the person was coming. So it's quite fun. I mean, it was.
Yeah, I think I'm very kind of new to all this. I had a birthday a few weeks ago and decided that as I couldn't get the plumber in to do the job that he was due to do, I might as well spend the money on a PlayStation. And we're at a very, very early stage, but I like the idea that it'd never occurred to me that there were games where you cooperated instead of had a go at each other. Moving you swiftly on, I understand we have so-called real sport coming back in leaps and bounds.
Well, yes. Although Manchester United had their friendly cancelled because someone at Stoke tested positive for coronavirus, which I think is something we all expected to happen, but nobody has apparently planned for it. We kind of saw that one coming a mile off. So what actually happens with that restart next week at the Premier League, we'll have to wait and see. Like I mentioned last week, kind of Formula One's coming back. Basketball in America have just signed a deal with Disney to kind of house, I think it was 22 NBA teams in one location, and they can all kind of play games against each other in a venue that's all going to be kind of televised, which, you know, hopefully it stays safe and there's testing and they kind of get them in and then tell them they can't leave to kind of protect them all from, you know, with the interactions of having to go out and things. But, you know, I'm kind of looking forward to, but hesitant about, the return of sport. But hopefully in the next kind of few weeks, there will be some live sport back on the television that we can kind of sit back and and enjoy.
I mean, from a participative perspective, yeah, some of the outdoor stuff's going on, but I quite worryingly, I saw a letter this morning that's going to the minister from the DCMS and somewhere else, basically from Swim England and a lot of swimming pool providers who are hugely concerned that actually there's going to be many, many pools that won't be able to afford to open again, you know, because they've lost their entire income. Their entire income comes from people paying to go swimming. And a lot of these, the way it was written anyway, is they're going to be local authority venues which haven't been able to get furlough money or, you know, grants as businesses or anything like that. So actually the local authority pools where everyone who, you know, contributes to the local economy is effectively paying into, are at the moment kind of going to rack and ruin. So it's going to be quite a challenging time, even when they do say, yes, you can go back to sport. You know, what facilities are still going to be available afterwards?
Yeah, I think it ties in really nicely to, you know, kind of together being an arts organisation, but coming out of a sporting event. The kind of what we were talking about last week or a couple of weeks ago around, you know, kind of theatres and galleries and things not being able to open in a way that's economically viable with social distancing, I think is exactly the same issue with pools and leisure centres or whatever. You know, that problem is prevalent kind of across industries. I think it's going to be a really big problem going forwards. Not to get too kind of dreary on a Wednesday afternoon, but...
No, well, I think these things are important. Penny, can you hear us?
I can. Can you hear me?
Yes, then we brought you back on screen to carry on this conversation. I always think one of the links, Josh, is that once you do dance is called physical activity and then it falls under sport, apparently. This has been part of my journey of discovery since setting up Together 2012. Yes, it's very much described as sport and therefore you fall into sort of sporting things. But we're all rounded people. Disabled people are not just benefits claimants or being discriminated against work or artists or Paralympians. We are all of these things and more. I mean, we've been planning ever since we started to open our own arts centre, the David Morris Cultural Centre. And David Morris was the head of external inclusion at London 2012, but died suddenly in 2010. Within that building, there's going to be the Sophie Partridge Studio. And I was thinking about our friend Sophie, who I think died, was it three years ago? Yes, it must be 3 years ago, because we were taking part in an event to remember her on Friday. And what it gives us now is the opportunity to design a building that's fit for the new normal. So we'd already talked about things like having all the toilets in separate cubicles, because there's lots of benefits for that, but that's also going to make it much easier to clean. We'd looked at having very wide corridors, because it's always so difficult when you have wheelchair users passing each other. That's going to make social distancing much more straightforward. Our architect, Sarah Wigglesworth, was actually featured in The Guardian at the weekend, which I was very pleased about. She built a very famous live-work base down the side of King's Cross 20 years ago. It was featured on the first series of Grand Designs, and it's been featured a couple of times since, and I think that's what they were looking at. And of course, we're also very keen to make sure things are environmentally friendly. I worked with Sarah once in the past, and what I like about her is, why install a very expensive air conditioning system when you can open a window? And now, of course, the air conditioning can actually spread the virus, so there's even more reason just to be able to open a window. What's happened to cultural venues in Hastings, Penny?
They have been rather severely hit. We have had all our big festivals cancelled because it's a festival town. There's been some efforts to put everything online, but as you can imagine, it's not the same as actually being at a live event near the seaside. Because we've had this amazing thing, and I've only just dipped my toe into the water with it, as it were. We have Hastings Contemporary, which used to be a Gerwood. So it's a really lovely art gallery, very accessible. But they've done live robot tours. I would encourage people to look at them. It's a robot that you can tour around the gallery, and it's been featured far and wide, which is lovely. And also we have something called Isolation Station, which is a TV streaming, Together Unlocked. And it has all sorts of things going on every day. So as a community, we're doing quite well. But I do think that the live stuff, of which we have a lot, has suffered greatly.
Bringing it back to the West Mids, I mean, we'll talk about it more next week, but it's quite encouraging. There are at least a lot of conversations going on between a whole host of Midlands arts organisations on how to deliver accessible digital festivals, I mean, including big names like the RSC. So there is things in the offing for live being a live audience in something that is produced digitally or produced over the internet.
Yeah, I suppose, I mean, one of the things that we often forget about as artists is all of the other people that work in a venue, you know, whether that, you know, starting at the person who welcomes you through, tells you where the cloakroom is, sells you your ticket, sells you your drink and your ice cream, you know, works backstage. I've often thought it was a real gap, if you like, in the Arts Council funded support for disabled artists that we're seeing in isolation, you know, that actually what we want is disabled stage managers, theatre and film directors, we want disabled people at the door, we want disabled people doing the lighting, we want disabled people doing the sound. And there's never been, as it is, a single thing, a single programme to support those people. It's going to be, I think, particularly difficult now. I mean, again, just things like not being able to travel on public transport if you're prone to infection is going to really cut off work for a lot of people. And I think that's the difficulty. There's still this focus on, well, if we can't make any money because we can only have a third of the people in the auditorium and we need it 80% full to break even, we can take it online and we can get X number of people to stay. But there's still a huge number of front of house and backstage people who just don't have a job scenario. I think we have to get back to a sort of sensible grown-up conversation about getting rid of the virus, however long it takes. You know, it was so nice to see people in New Zealand hugging each other, but it just brought it home to us that there is already a substantial divide between the UK, the US, Southern Europe, and the rest of the developed world. And, you know, frankly, who's going to want us as tourists at this point? I would settle for being able to get out of the house next year. I don't ask for much. I know the scientists and politicians have a great deal to do. We knew in March that we could be pretty much indoors apart from essential things for a very long time, but the idea that we can just let it go when the rest of the world is doing so much to make sure it's gone, I think is just unrealistic. And the same way, I think when I look at the sports, what I'm really looking forward to is the South Korean football, because they're playing almost normally. But in South Korea, you know, things are really spiking up. But I think it's terribly unfair to expect a code of behaviour from people like footballers and Formula One drivers, let alone the support staff, that our own politicians aren't prepared to adhere to. You know, if you've got government advisors having their partners visit, government advisors going to second homes. Let's not even talk about the most senior government advisor and his behaviour. Are we really putting the fate of an entire industry on making those sports people have a higher code of conduct than our politicians and our advisors? It doesn't seem realistic to me, and it certainly doesn't seem fair if we suddenly end up blaming one individual for the whole of Formula One collapsing when government ministers are getting away with it and advisors are getting away with it. I just think in practice, as Josh was saying, it was just all too predictable that somebody was going to test
positive. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I think it's really unfair that sports people get held to such a almost kind of, it's not a double standard, but you know, you see it in times like now with you know, the Black Lives Matter protests and things. Lots of sports people and professional sports people, especially in America, you know, speaking out, and you know, that group of society that unfortunately exist are stay in your lane, pipe down, you're an athlete, go back to bouncing a ball or whatever. But then as soon as they, you know, they walk outside and forget to put a mask on or something, they're vilified and they're a role model to children. They've got this huge platform and they're setting a terrible example.
I would argue that disabled sports people are held to an even different standard, but we must leave that conversation there. On Friday, we will be having more usual Friday items, starting with dressing up to go out to stay in, where we encourage our audience turn up dressed for a real or imaginary journey that we won't be taking. We would really encourage you to send us your photos and videos of you dressed up to go out to stay in. We also have our regular something for the weekend spot, where we recommend all sorts of things that are available online and on the TV over the weekend. And of course, art and music. But I'm going to say goodbye from East London.
And goodbye from East London.
And I'm going to hand over to the West Midlands, and then we're going to bring Penny Pepper back to finish with a poem.
It's goodbye from the West Midlands.
And it's goodbye from the east of the West Midlands.
So we'll say goodbye, guys. Ask you to mute your mics, and I will bring Penny back. Over to you, Penny, for the final words.
Hello. Drew was just talking about the dressing up to go out to stay in. And my last poem, Bling, is on that kind of thing about how we get gadgets that support us of disabled people, and they're often really dull. You have to do something about it. So this is called Bling. Please let me bling my invalid tray. It's dull and it's worthy, might as well be grey. I love it because I need it and it helps me work and play. But, oh Lord, let me bling my invalid tray. I got a bit of plastic. Does it make me feel fantastic? Does it label me spastic? It makes me feel sarcastic, but I'm iconoclastic. Let me bling this thing, make my little world sing. I'm whining and I'm dying. It's perspexing. Let me do it. Let me screw it. Let me free with some bling. Enthusiastic, I'm full fashionastic. Purple, green, I dash it. With colour, I will splash it. Make me orgiastic. Let me bling this thing. Make my little world sing. I'm rhyming and I'm dining. It's perspexing. Let me do it. Let me skew it. Let me free with some bling. Let me free. Let me free. Let me free with some bling. Thank you. And goodbye from Hastings.